David, how have investors or companies or consumers taken advantage of this low interest rate landscape?
It's interesting because generally speaking, one would think that at a point where there is or is expected to be inflation, that interest rates would increase along with inflation. Every once in a while, you find yourself in a real life situation, which economists would say shouldn't happen. And we're at that inflection point right now where interest rates are very low and inflation, all of the news seems to be pointing that it's already arrived, but everyone seems to agree with the expansion of the money supply that it certainly will be with us for a while. And so the way that most investors are reacting, frankly, is accessing cheap debt. Now, let's point out one important factor. There's a difference between cheap debt and available debt. And so that not all borrowers are able to access unlimited amounts of cheap debt, but those that are able to, that have the creditworthiness to be able to borrow, are doing so in record amounts because the cost of borrowing is so low. And that is on a nominal basis. In other words, the interest rate itself is a very low number. But if you consider the fact that there is inflation, that if I borrow $100 from you, and I pay you a really low rate, like 2.5%. When I pay you back 5 years from now, the $100 that I need to pay you back is effectively only going to cost me $95, $93 because of inflation. And so you have a situation where people are effectively being paid to borrow money. And when I say people, it could be investors that are borrowing to make general investments, but could also be companies that are accessing leverage to grow, knowing that when they pay back the debt, that it will be easier to do so.
I want to pick up on this notion of being paid to borrow, because even with the prospect of rates rising, it's going to be such a nominal rate rise, if you will. Are we going to continue to see this evolve, this being paid to borrow notion?
Well, that you bring up a really good point. The only time we see really significant changes in interest rates is usually when they go down in response to a financial crisis. We certainly saw that in March and April of 2020 when COVID hit, where we saw the base rate go down by 1.5% virtually overnight. Rates don't go up at the same speed that they go down. And the reason they don't go up so quickly is that central banks and other lenders are very wary of the effects that increasing rates too quickly could have, because it could crush, you know, borrowers' ability to pay those rates, and you could have a significant impact on the entire system. Now, that said, the cost of your flat screen TV can go up a lot faster than the rate of borrowing, which means that you can see inflation outpacing increase in interest rates by a lot. So that when I speak to investors who are borrowing, are they aware of the fact that the rate could go up, especially if they're borrowing, say, on a line of credit, which has a floating rate and not a fixed rate? They're aware that if they're borrowing today at prime, which is 2.45, that maybe it goes up to 2.95, even 3.50. And they think at 3.50, it's still a great deal. And they're aware of the fact, of course, that what they're investing in, if it's, for example, a real asset or something else that is directly related to the rate of inflation, we'll probably get into that a little later in our chat, that the increase in the value of what they're investing in will significantly outstrip the increase in the cost of debt, which is procured in order to buy that investment.
David, let's talk about some of these elements that you had just touched on. When you take a look at household debt, when you take a look at borrowers' ability to pay back debt, when you take a look at corporate leverage levels, mm-hmm. are we headed for a perfect storm here?
That's a great question. And actually, the answer depends in no small part on the use of the debt. So when households expand their own household balance sheet by borrowing to buy a large screen TV, that's different than a company borrowing to make an acquisition or to expand its workforce so that they can actually increase production, thereby increasing their profits. Generally speaking, ever-increasing amounts of debt doesn't end well. And anyone who's ever borrowed money, even on a credit card, understands that times are great while all you're paying is a little bit of interest. But after a while, when you keep paying the minimum amount on your credit card, eventually the minimum amount becomes more than you can afford. And I know that I'm really bringing it very granularly down to the individual amount, but the metrics are the same. The economics are the same, whether it's a large corporation that becomes overly indebted. And what happens is that you lead, it leads to a deleveraging period. Deleveraging is typically a bad word when you talk about the economy and you talk about investing, because what'll often happen is that whether it's the person who's borrowing for their own account or whether it's someone borrowing to grow a firm, at the end of the day, the banks determine not only the rate, but the amount. And if banks get scared that there's too much leverage in the system, they can pull back. And so the bank can call and say, you have $100 of leverage. We'd like you to reduce that to 80. So think about what that leads to. That leads to forced selling at the point of a bayonet, which leads to crash in prices, which can lead to a financial crisis. And it really is that simple, that it's not that different than a personal household trying to get rid of its enormous amounts of debt, that when you see debt at so many different levels being used irresponsibly, like imprudently, that's when you can lead to a deleveraging cycle, which is, it's destructive on a lot of things, but especially to GDP.
David, you had mentioned inflation, something which is very topical right now, and whether it's a transitory or permanent rather. Tell me about investing in a time of inflation. I mean, investors seem to worry there was, you know, too little inflation or now too much inflation. Where is that sweet spot?
So it depends where you are in both the capital stack and where you are in the capital markets. Generally speaking, if you're investing and you expect inflation, you'd like to be investing in something that should benefit from inflation. So let's look at it really simply. Inflation is generally measured by the Consumer Price Index, CPI. That's sort of what most outlets use as a measure of inflation. And what are the biggest components to CPI? This will surprise nobody: food and rent. I mean, those are the two things that everybody must spend money on all the time. And so as they measure it and they see the values, or excuse me, the prices going up, that's what sort of makes up for inflation. At the end of the day, I think that what I would like to own is the food and the rent, if I'm thinking that things are going up in value or in cost. And so what does that mean? It means real assets. And this is, by the way, a story as old as time, that if you own, for example, the apartments that people are paying more rent on, you will benefit from inflation. If you own farmland, which produces the food that people eat, and the price of food goes up, the value of the farmland would go up. And that is true with a lot of infrastructure and other real assets along the way. We've actually seen that already with timber. Everyone knows that lumber prices went through the roof during the last 6 months. They came back a little bit in June and early July, another real asset. What you wouldn't want to own in an inflationary period is something that has a fixed return. So we talked about how great it would be that you could borrow and effectively get paid to borrow. You don't want to be the lender. So that if you are buying bonds and you're the lender, that means that you are accepting a very low rate now, and you're going to get back in real terms less money later. So bonds would not be considered in any way to be a good, what they call, inflation diversifier, because they are indirectly related to inflation. And so therefore you see a lot of folks turning the dial towards things like real assets. Now there is another area that tends to benefit from inflation, and that's the public stock market, something that we're all invested in one way or another. And the public markets tend to go up during inflationary periods because the public companies tend to make things that people buy, whether it's goods or services. And if during an inflationary period, the cost of those things goes up to the consumer, that means that the manufacturer of those goods or services is making more money. So that the value of a share of Apple should go up over time. The real question, though, isn't whether the value goes up in nominal dollars, it's whether the value goes up in real dollars. So one would hope, if they're buying a share of Apple, that the value of the share of Apple goes up at least by the rate of inflation, so that the spending power of that one share of Apple is the same 5 years from now as it is today.
Indulge us for a moment, if you will. some of the conversations that you're having right now with your clients, what is top of mind? What are the biggest concerns as we, unwind some of that debt, some of those support programs, as, you know, vaccine rollouts continue, there's still this threat of possible variants. What are the biggest concerns for your clients?
So, and they, you know, we're actually quite far into the pandemic now. So we've had a chance for people to sort of internalize the risks associated with the pandemic, some of the opportunities associated with the pandemic. And I think that a lot of analysts are very focused on companies that do well all the time, but especially well during times of crisis, and other companies that might have done well during the pandemic, largely because they had so much government support. So to your point, that support will wane. Eventually, it will reduce to some degree. And will the patient be able to live without the meds, is another way of putting it. And so that it's very important as investors look at investments that they be able to identify that they can continue to perform as they have performed. I mean, we've seen this incredibly steep V recovery where when we spoke at the depths of the pandemic and I said, usually in a crisis, the best thing to do is absolutely nothing. In this particular case, that's never been more true because things bounce back so quickly. But now that we are back and well beyond where we started, those are the sorts of questions that people are asking. If a variant comes or if something else were to occur, am I well positioned so that I don't have to have quite as bumpy a ride next time that I had the first time?